All right. I do not own the rights to this music. This is the great Gladys Knights and the Pips. Well, Gladys Knight and the Pips, I've got to use my imagination. Welcome. I'm Dr. Cedric Hackett, and I am excited to bring to you a great discussion. We're calling this talk the intersection of the Blaxploitation film genre and Afrofuturism with our very own Christopher St. John and Leonard Clifton. I'm excited about this. And so just a couple housekeeping. If you want to make comments in the chat, feel free to do that. If you have questions that you'd like to ask, use the Q&A feature and we'll see if we can get a question in for you. Okay. All right. So what you can see here is a something that I think is not only special, but gives us an opportunity to reimagine and look at implications on a broader level as it relates to the Black experience in terms of storytelling, in terms of acting, in terms of film, in terms of producing. And real quick, let me just start reading off the bios of our two wonderful speakers. Christopher St. John, sometimes credited as Chris St. John, he's an American film and television actor. He's also a film producer, film director, and screenwriter, and played a minor role in the television series Remington Steele. A member of the Actors Studio starting in the mid-1960s, St. John is best known for playing the role of Ben Buford in the 1971 Blaxploitation film Shaft. But between 1968 and 1988, he appeared in 8 film and television productions. In addition to appearing as George Latimer in Top of the Heap, where you'll get a clip in a minute to kind of put it into context. In 1972, he not only acted in it, he wrote and directed and produced the film. He was entered into the 22nd Berlin International Film Festival and was nominated for the Golden Bear, the festival's biggest prize. Richard Brody of the New Yorker described the film as a crucial work of Afrofuturism during the Blaxploitation era, right? So Chris's Top of the Heap movie was recently featured in the Brooklyn Academy of Music and the LA Times recently by Nicholas Rapol, a film historian. And that took over a year of getting it together. So now let me introduce Leonard Clifton. He started as a print model, which led him to acting. His first Hollywood job was in Tupac Shakur's Temptations music video. And his first role, was in Steven Spielberg's Amistad. He went on to have roles in several other films like the cult classic Bring It On, television productions, and international commercials. Leonard loves writing and supporting his favorite charities, traveling the world. We'll get a chance to see where he's traveled in his books and through his imagination, and is always seeking new adventures. He was the first author to have a Barnes & Noble book signing for Black History Month at the Grove in Los Angeles, and he was given a lecture about his book here at Cal State Northridge last year in 2020 during the pandemic on Afrofuturism. So without further ado, let us welcome to you Christopher St. John and Leonard Clifton. Let's give a virtual round of applause. I think we'll get started with it. How are you doing, Chris?
I'm doing well. I'm doing very quite well. Thank you very much for inviting me. I like it. I did UCLA one time, right? And it was a very interesting thing. You know, I've done other colleges also, but I like it because talking to students, I might be able to say some things that can help to endeavor them to be able to do things in their lives that are like big time stuff, right? Because you kind of have to think that way. You have to think that way, and you can't let anybody take you away from that type of thinking. Believe me, it happens a lot. It happens a lot. I remember when I was going to drama school in New York, I didn't know where to go. So I remember I went to a school in Carnegie Hall, 57th Street in New York City. And I started going to this school, and we had an instructor, a drama teacher, who was trying to tell me, do it this way, do it that way, do it, think this and think that. And I went there for about 6-8 weeks. And then one day I said, I can't go here anymore. I can't stay here, because I don't want you telling me how to do this, because I work from a level of inner, only on an inner level, right? It's organic, it's totally organic, right? I'm not thinking about this and that. I'm thinking about, well, I have to be this, so now I'm this. I have to be that, so now I'm that, right? And it would work for me, because I was working from some organic level, right? And I remember I stayed there a while. I did a play on stage there. And then one day I decided, well, that's it for me. I'm gone. I'm gonna do my own thing out in the world, right? And that's how I got started with my own theater company. I built my own theater. I did tons of plays there.
What was the theater company called?
It was called the Troupe Repertory Theater of New York City. It was a great experience. I remember I had no money, so I went out. Me and a friend of mine, was Paul Benjamin. You may know the actor Paul Benjamin, right? Paul and I had come from where he was. I think he came from Alabama, something like that. He came in, we met, and then he started working with me, building the theater. We went out and we found wood on the streets of New York City, where they were building this and building that. We carted back that late at night on our backs. We took it in and we built this theater. It was great. Built the stage, and I worked for a company that dealt in precious fabrics from around the world, right? And it was a real good job, you know. But I was able to get fabrics from there to take to my theater, and put we sewed some curtains. We sewed some curtains ourselves and put up curtains, rods, lights, everything, right? And made our own theater. And I worked there for about eight years doing plays, directing. I got myself a director's chair and said, now I'm a director. And that's how I did it. And I just had a good sense of what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. Right, that's what you have to do, man. You have to kind of do your own thing and know that you'll be successful if you work at it in the right way. If you put your mind and body and your organics into it, it will work. It will just work, right?
And I love it. We're having
a period of time.
I'm sorry, I was going to say we're having an organic conversation, as you mentioned. So you'll see that this is going to be non-traditional, right? This is the way we're going to be talking. Okay, now I got. And so I think you're stuck there, but while we're getting the Wi-Fi adjusted, I want to show just the short video clip original trailer of his movie from 1972, Top of the Heap. Very, very compelling film. And we'll talk a little bit about the Black exploitation film genre and Afrofuturism. Can you hear that? Starring Christopher
St. John. Perfect, I can hear.
Ain't gonna be no day like that. You're gonna have to shoot me right in my face, Mr. Black Pig.
When a black man bares his soul and tells his story, he lets it all hang. His rage was the illness of the times.
Hey, just got back to accept the moon.
Hassled by his soul brothers, with his mother dying, he can only escape to the moon.
You're gonna have to kill me, nigga!
Drop that knife! Drop it!
How are you trying to do, huh? Are you trying to kill me, you black bastard? I found a uniform, and I go out there in the streets, and people look at me, and they hate me!
Because you're a mean, selfish man.
Captain Latimer, how's the training for the flight been like?
Isolation, sort of like waiting at the mailbox for your welfare check.
A little itch here.
Yes, sir?
Pick up your uniform.
Yes, sir.
Hey, mother, you want me to pull out my thing and throw you a new hole? Hey! Damn, brother, you the man?
The most unusual picture of its time, starring Christopher St. John, whom you last saw in Shaft.
I'll do any damn thing I want.
Come on, you nigga bitch.
Top of the Heap is a powerful, dynamic story as only a black man can tell it.
So that kind of gives you kind of a little bit about his film. And I can tell you, having watched it, it is a spectacular film in the 70s. And it's just crazy that it happened in the 70s. And we're having a conversation yesterday during Easter, you know, preparing for this talk. And as we're talking, I thought about the African proverb that I always use, right? And that proverb is, until lions have their own storytellers, tales of the lion hunt will always glorify the hunter. And it's interesting, the reason why I thought about that and thought about Christopher St. John's movie in terms of his own storytelling, I think about the women rights activist, Audre Lorde, who really writes about the master's tools being never dismantled in the master's house, right? They may only allow us temporarily to beat him at his own game, but they will never enable us to bring about general change. And so I wanted to start there and just ask the question, how you got into it, right? Well, what motivated you to tell your own story? You mentioned a little bit about, your experience with the dramatic workshop at Carnegie Hall. Talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, you know, I had when I was like 12 years old, I would play hooky from school, and I would go to a little theater downtown in my hometown, and I would see movies, sit in the balcony, of course, and see movies, right? And I saw a couple of Sidney Poitier movies when I was 12 years old. And he was about, I guess he's like 10, 12 years older than me, right? So he's a grown person. But I remember looking at him and thinking to myself, maybe I should be an actor. I can do that. I can do that. I know I can do that, right? And so whenever I knew that he had a movie in town, I would go and see it. I'd sit there all day long and watch it over and over and over again. And I kept thinking to myself, I think I can do that. Although, you know, I was a very shy, bashful person. I found out later that shy people are better actors than other people because they need the adulation of getting on stage, and now they have the time to show themselves as an actor, to benefit themselves being an actor. And so I thought, well, I can do that. Even though I was just a quiet kid, I would hide from other people and stuff like that, right? But it was the silence of my soul that I thought that if I was able to be an actor, I could maybe do some things that I could dream of. I could dream, and that's why Top of the Heap is a movie that I just dreamed about. I swear this is true. I didn't sit down and write something and say, well, I'm gonna do that. That's not what happened. I actually would dream about it at night, wake up in the middle of the night, write some stuff down, and then get up and go back to bed, you know, and then wake up the next morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, you know, on the clock, and I'd sit there, I'd write some more. In a very short period of time, I had this movie written, and I'm going, oh man, where did all this come from, right? Because I certainly didn't think it up. I didn't think it came from someplace, right? I know that. It's hard to explain it to people, but it came from some other place. And that's true, right? And a lot of artists are like that, and they get messed up in the business, or the business tries to change them. But I felt like if I let them change me, then they're going to change me, right? I'm not going to let them do that. I'm going to do my own thing, the best I can do with that, you know, and trust it. That's how Top of the Heap was born.
That's
and
awesome.
I swear to you. So many years later, as I see it now, I realize I said, well, some of the things that I look at and say, how did I do that? I remember doing it, but I don't really remember writing it, so to speak, because it came from some other place, right? I know that, right? And so it's hard to explain to the people because a lot of people don't want to understand that, right? And also because the problem of being Black 50 years ago was a real deep, deep problem, right? And somehow I was able to recognize that and I was able to say, okay, I'm not going to let them derail me in any way. I'm not going to let them destroy my life in any way. I'm going to work through this whole thing and be smart about it and be smart about how I make my moves, how I'm able to move from here to there to there and get some stuff done. Because when I was going to say something like this to the students, when you let people anger you or take you to the point that you become angry at them, right? And you blow your scene and you self-destruct yourself, right? You're not going to be able to do your stuff. You're just not going to be able to do your stuff. So I recognize that that's what their job was. The white people were trying to destroy me to keep me down. Even Black people would tell me things like, well, if you want to be an actor, you better get a nose job because they won't let you be a nose job. They won't let you be an actor. I said, they got nothing to do with it, man. It's on me. It's on me to work my way through it. All the stuff that they put at me, that they shot at me, I was able to work through all that stuff, work through it all. And little by little, I said, I'm making progress. I know I'm making progress because I'm learning this, I'm learning that. And that's how I got through it. Because otherwise, I could not have gotten through it because they could. And I see a lot of white actors who blow their minds completely because they can't deal with it. And they fight and fight and fight, right? And suddenly they get derailed, totally derailed. And I wouldn't let that happen because they said, I'm going to make something of myself. I'm going to do it.
And I'm going to ask questions later
about
the, you know, what happened at the Oscars. But you mentioned Sidney Poitier, and God bless his soul. He passed away early January of this year in Beverly Hills. You had encounters with him. You said you watched him, but you actually knew him.
Yeah. It was, well, what happened was that when I left my hometown in Connecticut, I moved to New York, and I met this guy who was picketing a company. He was picketing a company on his own, this guy, right? And I was walking by 57, he said, hey man, do you want to come and help me do this? And I said, well, what is it? He said, I'm picketing this company because they don't hire Black people to be in commercials and stuff like that, right? And I said, oh, okay. So I started working with him on 57th Street, this company. And then one day we had our signs in our hand. We're walking up the street, our 57th Street, and I see this Black man walking towards me. He was dressed to the nines, looked great. And I said, oh my God, it's Sidney Poitier. Oh my God. I walked up to him. This guy I knew him. He said, oh, hi, Sidney, how you doing? I said, you know Sidney Poitier, you know, and then Sidney invited me to be in his film almost immediately. He was doing a film in New York. He invited me to be in his film, and I'm standing there, I'm looking at Sidney Poitier, and he was the nicest gentleman I had ever met and seen, and because, see, when I was a kid, I didn't believe that film stars were real. When I was a little kid, I didn't believe they were real. You know, I just thought they're not real because how can you have a big image like that on the screen and they'd be real, right? But when I met Sidney Poitier, he was so nice to me and such a gentleman, and he invited me to be in his movie. And just like that, I was in his movie. I forgot what it's called now, but it was in his movie, and it was like, it was a great experience. And he bought me a tuxedo, and I still have that tuxedo.
Wow.
55 years later, I still have that tuxedo in my closet, right? And I look at it and say, this is the tuxedo that Sidney Poitier bought for me, right? And now I see him throughout the years, you know, in different places. And he would come to me all the time and say, listen, we need you. We need you. We need your strength. We need your energy. Because he had seen Top of the Heap, and he knew that I was working on a different level. He was a film star, a big film star by then, right? So I was working on a whole different level and trying to shake things up. And so I said, okay, I want to be in your movie, man. I just want to be. So he would always, when he would see me, he would say, we need you. We need you. And I would think to myself, I don't know why Sidney Poitier would need me. You know, I mean, I just made this little movie, and I don't know what they did to me, because it was not a great experience, by the way, making the movie, because I had to fight with a lot of people. Right? I had to fight with a lot of people who wanted to make a movie, and his producer, his executive producer was like, I just want 90 minutes of niggas on the screen. That's all I want. That's what he said to me one day. You know, I remember looking at him and thinking, the guy's crazy. He's very, very crazy, right? And nothing I can do about it except keep on going, because I want to get this done. And that's what you have to do when you're working like that, and you blow your mind. If somebody says something to mess you up, you can't get into a big fight, because what'll happen is that you'll part company. That's what I'll have, your part company, and you won't get your work done. And I thought that what I was doing was probably important. It was probably important, because this is the first movie where I got locked into this thing about being an astronaut. And this, don't forget, this movie was about 10 or 12 years before the first Black astronaut got into the astronaut corps. 10 or 12 years before, right? And a lot of people don't know that, because when they see it now, they just see me in a spacesuit kind of thing. But I was like there doing that, and I don't know why, but it just happened that way, right? It just happened that way, and that was the thing that gave me the understanding that keep doing your work. Don't try to tear you down and tear you apart, but just keep pushing as hard as you can, and don't let them destroy you, because they will if they can. That was their purpose in life, to destroy me. And actually, the sad thing is, 50 years later, they're still trying to do the same thing.
Wow. So let me put this in the context. In terms of this blaxploitation film genre, which you believe, and I believe, that your film is not a part of, but it does have Afrocentric, Afrofuturist nuggets all writing through there. So the blaxploitation is a portmanteau for Black and exploitation. It's really a significant part of the cinematic history, and it's reflected some kind of historical progress that we as Blacks encounter in the U.S. But of course, the use of sensationalism and exaggeration proved to do more harm than good, right? And so the interesting thing is, as I was looking at some of the folks who wrote about Top of the Heap, Dennis Leroy Kangaly from the Luminal Theater, he talks about it being a mesmerizing movie that charts the mental deterioration of a Black cop, George Latimer, who eventually realized he must let go of any fantasy of getting to the top of the capitalist system as a cop, or as any other talisman of mainstream white approved success. And he talks about it being the moral question of being a Black police officer in a racist nation doing the bidding of the oppressor, hence the Audre Lorde comment I said earlier. And then Richard Brody in 2020 in The New Yorker talked about it as being an extension, an extravagant outer space element, and basically looks at it as a crucial work of Afrofuturism. And so I was fascinated by that, and bringing it to Leonard, Leonard, you basically wrote a book called The Last Prince of Atlantis. And just real quick, before we get you started to talk a little bit, I do want to just give a little bit of terminology on Afrofuturism. It was first coined by a cultural critic named Mark Dury in 1994 to explain the speculative fiction that treats African-American themes and addresses African-American concerns in the context of 20th century technoculture. But we know that Afrofuturism has been alive and well based on Christopher St. John's movie and his movement. There's a lot of pioneering Afrofuturist authors, including Samuel Delaney, Octavia Butler, Charles Sanders, Joel Gomez, and Leonard Clifton. Talk a little bit about your origin story, about how you came about, and how you met Chris.
Yes, well, thank you again, Dr. Sid, for allowing me to speak with everyone listening. I have to thank Christopher. When I first created this book, I just see him like about once a week watching football. I was telling him, writing the story. He's like, man, just keep doing it. Once you have that book cover, once you have that vision of what the character is going to look like, the book cover, you have your book. And about 6 months later, I remember just like vividly, like yesterday, I gave Chris a book and he was like, this is a movie. Just like that, literally. And it was like tears of joy. You can feel like his energy. He was really happy to see that I finished the book. So it came about with me. I just got tired of, at the time when I wrote this, and I would say the summer of 2011, August, September, I saw Twilight. It was on. I was like, man, I would start thinking like Twilight films, Harry Potter, Hunger Games. There's no Black protagonist characters, even multicultural Black characters in those stories. And that's why I said, you know what, I want to make one up. And just like what Christopher was saying, how he was writing, it just came to me. I wasn't really right. It was like I was on remote control. It was just the thoughts just came through me, a floodgate, and I was just writing and writing for 12, sometimes 18 hours a day for 6 months. I was literally exhausted. When I go to sleep, ideas are still coming to me. I was still downloading information from the source, or wherever you want to call it. And once I had the book, when it was completed, there was a publisher in New York was interested in it, the editor, but that publishing house at this time, they didn't have any Black young adult authors writing this type of books, you know, sci-fi genre. So I said, you know what, I'm gonna self-publish it. So I did it myself, wasn't sure where it was gonna go with it. And so once I did that, I had a book signing on my birthday on March 10th, back in 2012. And people were like, man, this is great. And I read an excerpt from it. Still didn't know how I was gonna like put the book out to the world. I put it on Amazon and those sort of things. But when I had the book signing at Barnes & Noble at the Grove for Black History Month, being one of the first authors to have a book signing, and I was named after Leonard Nimoy, he talked about the city of Atlantis, the rise and fall, you know, Plato talked about it in his stories. It's always been in me, but the source, it just came to me. It just literally, I couldn't stop writing nonstop. So when I did Barnes & Noble, that's when I decided to do my mentor, Reginald Rutherford, just like Christopher. He's like, now you got to do Comic-Con. I'm like, okay, now I have to create how the characters look. I didn't know anything what cosplay was. I didn't even know what that meant. Like you're creating a caricature from a story. So when I did the first Comic-Con, I don't have the pictures there. This is the recent Comic-Con I did. They invited me. So I had a little bit more special effects. You see with the eyes, the necklace glowing. Same thing here. You see with the Doctor Strange.
We only saw the Joker. Could you show that?
Yeah, the Joker. He's in a Batman. The guy looked literally like Heath Ledger. It was kind of eerie in a way. He had all the mannerisms, everything. This is from book two. This is an NFT, actually. It's a non-fungible token, you know, crypto art. And my good friend, Free Hester, created that. And he created a piece for Spike Lee, 10,000. I think Spike Lee paid for it. So this talented brother, he created that for me. But I traveled around the world after the first book, it was three books in one.
And all right, let me stop you right there because I want to show a short clip. Leonard and I embarked on, I wanted to use Leonard's book in my equity and diversity class. I figured Afrofuturism, especially for Black youth, would be a good response to motivating and getting them to reimagine futures with them in it. And I thought this book was perfect. And so we embarked on doing a project called the Real Black Man Read Project in Arusha, Tanzania. My former student, he founded this nonprofit corporation called Golden Era, right? Dedicated to connecting Africa and its diaspora and improving the collective condition through innovative programs and projects. Well, we're like, okay, we're going to do this and we're going to bring his book out in Tanzania. And so we had an after school program. We woke up at 5 a.m. and we did this thing. And so I'm going to show so that it puts it in context and then you can talk about what the book is. Okay. Just give us a kind of a brief synopsis after. Okay. All right. So let me go ahead and turn it back over here. I do not own the rights of this music.
I just want to say shout out to this book, The Last Prince of Atlantis Chronicles. And this is the first book, and I've been reading this, and it's actually a really, really, really good book. I love it. So we're going to tell you our favorite parts about it and why you should get this book. It's a really good book. Like why you guys should get this book. And it's a really good book. So Caleb's going to tell you his favorite part.
My favorite part is
it's a really cool. You gotta like read it. You gotta read it. You have no clue what he's talking about. But if you read this, you'll know what he's talking about. Not personally though. My favorite part is when like he figures everything out and stuff. And this one down to the underwater tree of life. You know, that part was pretty dope. When they're down there and he wrote the dolphin down there. That part was pretty dope. But yeah, so all in all, this is a really good book. And you guys should just go check it out. Especially because the school year is about to start, and I know y'all don't want to admit it, but y'all are gonna have to read. And I mean, y'all want some crappy books, like that's what I mean. You know, you want some crappy books, or y'all want to get some good books, okay? This book, amazing. I just want to say, it's amazing. It's sort of like, if y'all know me, I hate reading. But I actually read this book.
What's this? The Prince of Atlantis Chronicles. Al King is an unassuming Black teenager living in a blue-collar family in Miami, Florida. After finding a magical crystal necklace, he discovers that he's actually an Atlantean prince. Suddenly, things change for the gothic teenager. He gains the power of telepathy and teleportation, and finds that he's able to communicate with sea animals. Along with the beautiful Greek goddess, his orphan best friends, and a zany uncle, Alan keeps the Earth safe as they fight against his mortal enemies in an attempt to restore his kingdom, the lost city of Atlantis. Whoa. So, like, Aquaman, but like, Black Aquaman.
Okay, all right, so we'll stop there. Just to give you kind of a synopsis. So I was excited when I first got my hands on it. So talk just a little briefly and then we'll get back into the conversation with all of us.
Right. This was the original first Comic-Con. I was like, oh man, let me grab this picture. So we have Alan King, the last Prince of Atlantis, had the Greek goddess Athena. And I decided to cosplay as King Leon, Alan's grandfather, who teaches him how to be a noble warrior. So, man, just hearing that and just seeing how everything is manifested to this, it's like bringing tears in my eyes. Because literally, Christopher was the first person to hear these stories before anybody else heard it in the world. And being connected with you and seeing that video with the kids, it's really humbling because I made it for Lil Quincy and his friend. It's multicultural. It's a multiverse, you call it. It's for everyone. It's not just a black book. It's not just a white book. It's every race it represents. It's positivity. And that's what I wanted to bring.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, we know that, you know, the Black Panther made Afrofuturism, you know, just kind of reintroduce it to the world in mainstream America with its success with, you know, God bless Chadwick Boseman.
Yeah, he's where I got my gym. Great guy.
Oh, yeah. So you knew Chadwick?
From the gym, yes. I see him all the time work out. Yeah. The funniest thing is the LA Fitness, this is how humble the guy is, Chadwick. He will work out at LA Fitness, not Equinox, in one of these super expensive gyms. And I remember when Civil War came out, when Black Panther was introduced, he was still working out there. We played R.A. Jackie Robinson, he played James Brown. Everyone black knew who he was. Maybe only a few white people knew who he was. But when Black Panther came out, I was seeing that actually he was training. He was sparring with his trainer sometimes. I remember when the trainer saw him, like, she walked up to me. She saw me speak to him. And actually, I was talking to him, one of my good friends, Alvin Onyema, about his Jinko Foundation. And he actually sponsored Jinko, one of his films, I think 21 Bridges. But Chadwick was sparring on this outside before Black Panther was filmed. He's like, is that Chadwick? I'm like, yeah. It's like, well, I walked out and asked him who he was. He's like, no. he was in his mindset, just training, preparing for what he needed to do. He didn't want to be distracted, but he was such a normal person from what I've seen.
Thank you for that. So we know that there's various forms of Afrofuturism seen through paintings, literature, music, poetry, dance, digital media. And you can see in my backdrop, we have your NFT, this non-fungible token. That you created. Nipsey Hussle, his EP was to be released as an NFT in January, but it's since then been kind of, you know, on stall. I don't know what happened with that. But explain what this NFT thing is and what you did.
I'm still learning how it goes. I'm trying to keep up with it's so much technology. As I was mentioning, my friend Free Hester, he's a great artist. I mean, he's very innovative. And by him creating this, I saw some posts, him and a lot of his other friends. So he invited me to an NFT event downtown LA. It was like Hubble Studios. And it was like the first big NFT event. He was the only brother that had his art there with the Spike Lee art, with the piece of art he created. I'm just sitting here to like the metaverse. Literally, they flew with this guy from, I think, the Congo or Ghana. It was like this big African artist. They filmed him like you were in a concert, but it's a virtual concert. So you put the goggles on, you in the concert. I'm like, whoa. And my mom's like, this is exactly the same thing with The Last Prince of Atlantis Chronicles. It's a video game, it's a movie. I'm working on the script for that. It's all of that. So I just want to be ahead with everyone else. I have this NFT because I know as this continues to grow, it gets bigger. This art piece that Free created is going to become more expensive.
Right. I understand that an NFT is a unique digital identifier that can't be copied, substituted, or subdivided, right? And recorded in a blockchain.
Right. Exactly. Well, I'm still learning how that goes, but I just wanted to be a part of it for my brand. And I just leave it as that. So it's on LeonardCompton.com. You click the link for OpenSea. That is one of the main platforms for crypto art. It's amazing what these young kids are doing. Even they're creating this art. Some selling for hundreds of thousands of dollars, you know?
Oh, wow.
With the marketing, it's so much marketing you have to do. That's the one of the tedious things that I honestly hate to do. You constantly have to post on all these social media platforms just to try to stay relevant with everyone.
Right.
So as Atlantis continue to grow, I will have a marketing team for all of that.
You got role models, right? As Christopher St. John was talking about Sidney Poitier being his role model, you told me that Christopher St. John was your role model and that we should do something like this. You were the brainchild of making this happen. Talk about why is your role model? What interactions have you had with Christopher St. John Sr.?
Well, you just heard this brilliant man speak about how he feels about art and being a black artist in this world and what you have to do. And you can't, in a sense, it's almost like you're walking on eggshells and try to appease someone else. Christopher never did that. That's why he's so innovative and done what he's done. And same thing with me. So when I first did Tupac video, then I started doing a lot of modeling gigs and Amistad did. I actually had a big job. It would have changed my life with MTV. I would have hosted a show with Jenny McCarthy, Chris Hardwick, who's like a really huge right now. But I had a certain people was kind of controlling my mind in a sense, and I was kind of appeasing them. So I really screwed up that opportunity that I had because I missed the audition twice, but I was young at that time. And I thought about it, I'm like, if I didn't miss that audition the first time, where would I been now? But I mean, I have no idea. If I would have still be alive. I'm just saying at that time, I may have done something crazy, been around these people, been influenced. So everything happens for a reason. And in a lot of ways, this book really saved my life. I'm very thankful for this book. It's really put me in the audience of you and everyone who's watching and listening. So just stay true to your art form and the universe will bless you. Like things are manifesting now with this book. So I pray that the movie happens. If it does, it's gonna be epic, super epic, globally epic.
Thank you for that. Let's bring it back to Chris St. John. Chris, after hearing Leonard, you know, speak about you highly, about him, you motivating him and watching him, I obviously knows your son, knew your son, but we're going to stay away from that. What advice can you give other young storytellers and actors and producers who are trying to create their own way of seeing and exposing the world?
Well, first of all, I was going to start this program up by saying that, you have to have a real idea of what you want to do in the world. And also, you have to think to yourself, you want to fix this world. You want to fix it. You have to. That's your job. If you don't try to do that, what's your work going to be like? You know, and that's what I always thought. I have to do something about fixing this world. Somehow, right? I have to save this world somehow. And I honestly believe that. And I remember thinking to myself as I got older, I said, well, how the hell are you gonna save the world? And then I thought that, well, just keep believing it. Just keep believing that you're gonna save the world somehow, right? You don't have to, when you save the world, it's because you desire to save the world. And you keep that in your soul. And you keep working at that, no matter what is going on around you. And you don't let yourself be thrown out of the idea that you can't do that. You have to do it because that is your goal in life. You should make it your goal in life. You should do everything you can to be able to keep with your program, stay with your program. You have to play a game. Sometimes you have to play a game with other people. When other people you know are trying to destroy you, you can't let yourself self-destruct. You cannot do that, right? Otherwise, you're gonna be thrown off your game and you won't be able to do the work that you need to do to stay with the thought process that you need to change the world, right? Right? And that's what I liked about Leonard's book. It's this black man doing this thing that's great, this book that's a great idea, a fantastic idea, in fact, right? A fantastical idea. I love it. And I tell him, you just keep going. If you write 10 books about Atlantis, they'll all get done one day. They'll do them one after the other. Just keep doing them. And you will be the man. You will be the man, right? And you will know that you stayed with what you had, what you must do. You stayed with it. As long as you stay with it, one day it will happen. That's all that matters. You know, I'm going to tell you something. Top of the Heap, the cop in the show, I had two brothers that were cops, and one of them got shot, right? And this is why, in the Top of the Heap, I actually wrote the movie about my brother. Right, and he got shot at the and he actually he went on for some years later, but finally he died. Right, and my other brother who became a cop, he tried to do it, but he realized that he didn't want to do it, and he He quit in 2 years' time. He quit. He just left. He being a cop. He didn't want to be a cop. But my first brother, who got shot, you know, he tried to arrest a friend of ours. And he tried to arrest him. And he said, well, I just spoke and go talk to him and say, I got to arrest you, man. I got to take you in because you're doing drugs. You're selling drugs. You know, I got to take you in. He started a big fight with my brother. And he grabbed my brother's gun and shot my brother with his own gun. See? And so it was a heavy thing to me. I was younger than him. It was a very heavy thing to me when that happened. And that's one of the elements of why at the end of the top of the heap, this black cop gets killed, right? It's not a thing about a hero. It's just a guy. It's just a guy who was trying to do his duty, right? And this is what happened to him, right? And in top of the heap, that's when there's a lot of elements in the top of the heap that were things that actually happened in my life, right? The guy who was the police commissioner, he was same name in my hometown, right? I don't know if I did it purposely, but I just did it. I just did it, right? And some characters in the movie were people that I grew up with, right? And I actually used their names, right? And I didn't know, I didn't think, well, you can't use their name. I just did it, right? And it happened. So I'm telling you that you have to stay with what you're thinking, what you're believing. If you give up your belief, you won't do it. That's all that happens. If you give up your belief, you won't do it. Somebody else will do it.
So that was a form of historical fiction, so to speak, right?
No matter what they do to you, you have to find a way to work through it, to keep going and keep going and keep going until you reach a goal for yourself, to reach that goal for yourself. That's just the best you can do in this world, right? And if you decide that, well, like I said, I always believed I was going to save the world. I'm still saving the world. That's my goal in life, right? That's my goal. And that fire burns inside me right now. And I will keep working at that until I pass from this earth, because I know I'll leave behind some work that will be able to be good for people who are still alive, who see this work and say, yeah, that's the guy, he was saving the world. He saved me. I might have had people tell me that. I've had people who are successful in Hollywood tell me that contact me and say, you saved me, you changed my life, right? And I know it's true. I know it's true because if you believe it, it will happen.
You know? Well, you talked about the whole scene of being an astronaut, and then that scene with your mother and going through the wall, you know, with the Western Union and everything. Was that the hardest moment? I mean, you know, because I call myself, I'm my daddy's son, but I'm a mama's boy. You know what I mean? And so I wanted to figure out, you know, what was the impetus for creating that?
That was difficult to say. So my mother never saw this movie. She was not well, and she didn't go to movies at that point. She was ill. And that was a scene that happened because I was on the set shooting a scene. I was gonna shoot this scene, that scene in the street. And this guy showed up, the producer I was working with, this point guy, and he shows up and he's saying, what kind of movie are you making? What kind of movie are you making? I just want 90 minutes of niggas on the screen. What kind of, and I got so angry, I had people throw him off the set. They literally dragged him off the set. Right, he was putting up the money for the movie. And I said, I don't care, at this point in time, drag his ass off the set, get him out of here, right? And then by the time I got out to do the scene, I've been doing some background work about how I was gonna actually act the scene out, right? And I knew that I had to cry. I knew I had to actually cry big time. And by the time I got out into the street, after this incident with this guy, this producer came on the set. I'm thrown off, I'm dragged off actually. I came out of my trailer and I started doing the scene. And for that deeper I got into it, the more I was affected by what he did to me. And I realized, I said, that's what actors do. They work by the stuff that happens to them at any moment in time. You recall it like that, it'll just come back to you. You recall it like that, and then that worked for the scene. So in a strange kind of way, I was happy that he showed up on the set that day and caused that big ruckus. I had him thrown out and I came out to do this and I let him shoot it, you know, and I did this whole scene. And then by the time I got to the woman playing my mother, right, you know, I just believed it was my mother. You know? And I remember sitting, kneeling down, and she started whispering to me. She started whispering to me. And I just, I, she was my mother. And I broke down at that point in time. And that's how that scene got happened. And she whispered to me below what the mic would pick up, right? And she kept saying, just do your work. Just do the work you have to do. This is very important what you're doing.
Yeah, see, you know, So
anyway,
that's touching to me too. My mother passed in December of 2020. And one of the things that I did, the only thing that the pandemic, you know, helped me with is that I get to watch the homegoing of me honoring her with an honorary doctorate from the University of Hackett. I created a University of Hackett. Hackett's in my mind. And she was a part of the service and support. And so I definitely understand. And I felt that emotion right there. Thank you for that.
Yeah, so then everything else that happened was stuff that happened that it got into the script. I wrote it into the script and I didn't know how it would play out. You know, I didn't. All I knew is that I had this movie. I think it's great. Leave me alone. Let me do this. Is this somehow how it's important? I know it is because the spirit has told me, get this done. Get it done, right? And so but by the time it was finished, the thing about the wall, breaking through the wall, stuff like that. And because of all the walls I've seen that were graffitied all over the place and terrible things said and things that people wrote that they had to write on these brick walls, right? That they were like in jail, right? And it just break through it, just break through it. You gotta break through it. And so it just, things just happen like that, you know? And so when the film came out and he, the executive producer, wanted it to be just a black movie. What he called just a black movie, right? And I knew it was more than that. And so I fought with them the best I could. And one day I went to the studio. I was going to steal all the film. Just take it out of the edit room, put it in my car, take it someplace, and not let them proceed with what's making the film. But then I realized that if I did that, they would arrest me. They would arrest me and put me in jail because of stealing that property, right? So I had to let it go. And finally, I fought for everything I could. And then I had to settle for what they wanted, right? But it was such a unique film that they couldn't destroy it. They couldn't destroy it because that's what he wanted to do, destroy it. You know, if you notice in that scene, there was language in the scene that he cut out purposely. He cut it purposely because I thought that language needed to be there because it was strong. It was strong and it had to be there because it had to amplify the whole situation about the way we were living as people, on what was happening to us as a people, and all those things, right? And he did that purposely because he wanted to, I don't know, shame me or something. I don't know what he was thinking. I told him you're totally stupid at what you're doing. You're ruining this movie in some way. And I think it would have been a much greater movie if he had not tampered with certain things in the movie. You know, I had a son, a little young boy, son in the movie. Now, people don't even know this. He cut him out of the movie. He cut my son out of the movie, and my son was like the future that I realized at that point in my life at the top that I could work with my son, having learned something as a cop, having learned something being in the society a little bit. I could teach him some things that would benefit him as a boy growing up. But he cut him out of the movie because he wanted to hurt me. I know it sounds weird, but that's what a lot of white people do. They do things like that, devilish things like that. You know, they're trying to hurt you. Like even, like I said, 50 years later, you know, some guy with the New York Times, he's still trying to hurt me. 50 years later, I'm going, and the movie has stood the test of time. He's still trying to hurt me, right? I'm going like, wow, man, look at this guy. What is he thinking? What is he thinking all these years later that he can still behave like that and try to think that way, right? But people, just because they're critics, it doesn't mean that they know anything about me, about Black people, about the race, about other people. And also, I realized that guy with the New York Times, he was kind of an idiot. You know, that's all. He was kind of an idiot, right? I realized that. And so I've been able to deal with things like that by realizing that, well, I'm just let it go. Yeah. I'm just going to let it go.
Because absolutely. Absolutely.
Reacted to everything, I'd be dead by now.
Yeah. I just, you know, when we have a multiverse, we have a multiverse and a myriad of experiences in the Black community, but they always focus on one strand, and that's the biggest issue. But Leonard, real quick, you had mentioned, you know, in your book, there's a lot of things that you talk about that you've experienced in your life, you know, with the two friends that were in the orphanage. You know, could you talk a little bit about some of those things?
Yeah. Jake and Francisco. Jake is the white kid. Francisco is the Latino kid that grew up in group homes. So they label, because they grew up in group homes, how they dress and how they act as their bad guys. So they feed off of that energy and actually act like they're bad guys. But they always protected Alan. Alan was kind of like the skinny kid, shy. So I'm a mixture of all those things. So when this necklace comes about, when they're working for these billionaire guys, salvaging a Black Bear's ship that has this treasure. So it has one of the crystals from the lost city of Atlantis, and Alan's eyes change from brown to blue green, like the necklace. That's when we realize he's not like a normal kid. And Jake and Francisco, they become superheroes. Literally, like you see how they transform their personalities, because now they're with Alan and Athena. Athena is the one who helps Alan go on his journey. She's related to Plato, she's related to Zeus. So the four of them together, they become these superheroes. So you see the transformation of Jake and Francisco there. They swear, they will get a girl knocked up. In book two, as you know, is polarizing from book one to book two in your class, that they're totally opposite, like suicide, pregnancy, all these things, totally opposite from book one to book two. And your students loved it. I was like, wow, they actually loved what I read, but I'm all of that. I grew up from all of that. The reason why I kind of got a little choked up, where I don't know what would have happened if I didn't blow the MTV opportunity, but it happened for a reason, because this book never would have probably ever been made. So I'm thankful for the universe for giving me this gift, to you, you're reading it. I'm all of that. And my main goal is, once this book turns to a global phenomenon, which I feel it, I really feel it's gonna happen, the films, video games, all those things, that I want to create a program for foster kids. Starting out here in this country, because a lot of kids in foster care, especially girls when they age out, they're victimized by these guys, sex trafficking, all those things. I want them to go to any college they want, do whatever they want, but once they become successful, they got to help the next person who is just like them. And that's how you can break that chain of the trauma. That's how I personally feel. Because I'm a product of that, but I rose above that. I'm really thankful for that. Like I said, I'm gonna get so much into it. A lot of opportunity was coming my way. Some jealousy happened. But with a family I was connected to, thank God, since I'm not connected with them anymore, so many more blessings has happened. And that's why I was saying to myself, if I wasn't connected to them then, when the MTV and all these other things came about, where would I be? But I'm where I'm supposed to be right now. This book is going to change a lot of people. And with the foster care program, that is definitely what I want to do. Once this book is done, I'm now connected to my father's side. Now I know, but I have a grandfather. There's something
really. Because you adopted yourself, right?
Yeah, I was. Yeah, that's why I'm good. Yes, I was. So now with my biological father's side, my grandfather, he was in World War II. It's like these urban legends, like in Germany, he survived 2 weeks pretending he was dead behind enemy lines, World War II, Germany. And so I have a lot of documents on him. There's a bill created about this man, Nathaniel Scott. And I want to do a story about him. Once this is done, I want to tell his story. And it was the reason why, I don't know why I was always fascinated with World War II. And I happened to be in a film with Morgan Freeman. It's on my IMDb page, what he produced about World War II, what happened to these men, these blacks, soldiers. It was called Port Chicago. It was a port in San Francisco area where it actually blew up. It was an explosion. So the brothers who survived, they're supposed to go home, but they didn't let them go. It's kind of a similar story with my grandfather, where he was an elite soldier and how the government treated him. It's sad. It's a tragedy. And you see a lot of homeless veterans, no matter black, white, or whatever, in this country. It's really sad that they fought, they gave everything, but in return, they didn't get what they promised. Some, and my grandfather's
40 acres and a mule, right?
40 acres and a mule, and he ended up in New York. And me and Christopher talked about this. He was going through shock therapy, and I think Christopher worked at a facility or something like that. It's a lot of things have to change in this country when it comes to soldiers who fought in war. What I'm trying to say. They give their all. We already know war is bad, what's going on right now in the Ukraine and Russia. It's nothing good comes from it. Just more trauma for the kids who's survived from that.
Yeah. Speaking of trauma, you know, you had mentioned that you did videos with Tupac and you've met and been on the set with Jada Pinkett. And I know that, you know, in the interest of time, we have about 15 minutes. You know, I wanted to ask how you guys felt about this whole Will Smith slapping Chris Rock. A black man slapping another black man on national TV. I just want to know your thoughts as we're bringing Hollywood to higher education right now. So let's get into the mix of that.
I like Chris.
Well, I was, hear me? Okay, go ahead. You talk? Go ahead. Okay, I was thinking about that. I hope, can you see me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Okay. I was very disturbed by what happened because it was in the eyes of the whole entire world. And you know what a lot of people said. See, that's what happens when you give brothers a chance. That's what they do. They act like fools, right? And I thought to myself, Will, how the hell could you let yourself do that? You know better than that. You're a trained actor, man. You've done a lot of stuff. This is what I'm thinking. You've done a lot of stuff. How could you allow anything to affect you to the point that you would actually get up from your seat in that arena, walk up to the stage, and slap a brother? How could you do that in front of the world, right? And then say the things you said, were awful, idiotic things you said, screaming them out like that. How could you allow yourself to do that, right? And actors are trained not to do stuff like that. they're trained to be to have a part of them that has a you stop. You can stop yourself at any moment in time because you know better. You're not going to take a knife and stab somebody with it. You're not going to take a gun and shoot somebody with it. You're not going to take a baseball bat and hit him in the head with it because you know better as an actor, because a part of you is saying, always says, stopping point right here, right? You can control yourself, right? And I was so shocked that Will Smith did what he did in the eyes of the whole world, because it not only made him look like a fool, but it made us, all of us, look like idiots to the world, right? See, because you know what they say, You can't give them a chance. You can't give Black people a chance like that because this is what they do. This is what they do, right? And that hurt. It's hurt a lot of people. I know it has. It's hurt a lot of people. And Will Smith should learn something very, very deep. That's a total life lesson. You know, if I were him, I would give my Academy Award back to them and say, I don't deserve this. What did I do? How could I allow myself to do something so idiotic? I was very hurt by it. I was really, really hurt by it. When I saw him do that, I almost broke into tears. I said, look, Will, look what you've done. You set us back 50 years now, just like that, with that kind of behavior, right? And those are the kind of things that we have to look at and say, well, you know, we as a people, we have to be better at what we do, behave better at what we do, you know, and use ourselves and our intelligence to be able to advance our cause, which we were doing some good work at that. And now I'm telling you that one thing has set us back a huge amount, right? And I hope that the young people now who are working and doing their stuff see that and understand that you can't be cheering him on. You can't cheer him. I don't care how much you think about him, he's a brother and so on and so. You can't cheer him on like that, because you have to look at it and say, look what he did. It was an idiotic thing for him to do. And he knows it now. He knows it, you know, and he should have resigned from the Academy. And it's going to hurt him. It's going to hurt his career. It's going to hurt a lot of people's careers, because a lot of people don't want you anyway. They don't want you anyway, you know. And now they're going to say, I don't want to hire him because I'm afraid. I'm afraid of him. I'm afraid.
Right. What would you say? What would you say about the excuse being that he stuck up for his wife, having you know, alopecia with
alopecia, yeah.
Alopecia, I'm sorry, with the hair and everything. How would you respond to that? You know, because there's folks in the Black community who are divided in this situation. You know, those who support Chris Rock, and then those who support Will, those who support Jada.
You know, I had a sister. She had it all over her body, from head to toe. She would go to Yale University and be quarantined in a place where they were studying what they could do about this, how they could solve this problem, right? And she, you couldn't go and even go in the room. You look to her class at her, so on and so forth. But she managed to live her life anyway, with all that happened to her. And whenever she was well, she would come home and her face was all different colors, and all her hair was gone, and arms and hands, everything were different colors, pink and black and all that kind of stuff like that, right? And she managed to live through it, right? And still have a family, raise a family, and nobody was going around trying to hurt somebody because of that, because those things happen. It happens. It happens. And Jada Pinkett should have known to tell him, hey man, what you doing? Don't say anything like that. Don't do stuff like that. But she seemed like pleased that he went up there and did that, which was just a kind of crazy kind of ego on her part to be able to have anything to say about how he did this And she was fine with it. How could she be fine with it? Because it hurt. It hurt everybody. It hurt the whole race. It hurt the whole, it does. And so that's something that she's going to have to deal with it in her life and think about it and not justify it. The same thing with Will Smith. That's what I feel. You know, a lot of people may not feel that way, but you know, a lot of different opinions on the net that people want to say that stuff, right? And say, well, it's all right that he did that. He went up and slapped Chris Rock. Chris Rock is a brother, man. He's a good man. He's a good guy, you know. And it was just so shocking. He shouldn't have done it. That's all.
I thought it was fake, and then up there like, well, no, it's actually real. Leonard, what do you think about this?
I hoped it was fake, but it wasn't. And when I realized it wasn't fake, I said, oh my God, what did he just do? What did Will just do? And Will, I always liked him, man. He was a great guy. You know, I thought he was a great guy. You know, I always liked him. And to see him do that was, to me, it was shameful, completely shameful. And then he goes up and receives an Academy Award, and he says some stuff, and it seemed false to me, you know, and all that kind of jazz. And then all the statements that are coming out afterwards seemed like they were statements made by his team.
Like he was still in character, and, you know.
Say this and that. Yeah, say this and say that and say this and say that. And he knows in the deep in his heart that he did a terrible thing. To me, anyway, he hurt me, and I know he hurt a lot of other Black people. And we are having a hard enough time as it is. On every street corner, in the ghettos, and everywhere, we're having hard enough time as a people
for him. Oh, and you know, in the comments, one of my students that I work with said it was a shame that this had to happen on the Oscars, a first all Black production. That I forgot. Yes, that was the first all Black production. Absolutely. And this is what happens. Thank you, Ashley, for bringing that up. What do you think, Leonard?
That's what I'm talking about, man. Oh. That's why I felt. If I saw Will right now, I would look at him and say, Will, what the hell did you think? What were you thinking, man, to do something like that? You know, and I would hope that he'd be able to look at me and say, I don't know, man, I made a terrible mistake. You know, and can you forgive me? I said, yeah, I forgive you, but it's done already, man. It's done. What you did is done already, right? And you hurt a lot of people. You hurt a lot of people. That's it. So anyway, man, all I can say is that the beat goes on, yeah, the work goes on, and I want to encourage the young people to do what they can to change the world, right? It's up to them. It's up to them to change the world, do all the things, to stay in the lane that they have to stay in, and keep thinking positive about, I'm going to change the world. I'm going to change the world somehow. You change it one by one, 1 by 10, 100 at a time, 1,000 at a time. You change the world. You can change the world by what you think, what you have going on in your heart, in your soul. What you can do to change this world, because it's got to be changed. Otherwise, some crazy guy over in Russia is going to cause a problem that's going to maybe take us all down.
Yeah,
you know, yeah. It's possible. It's very possible.
We didn't really get to talk a little bit, Clifton, on where you visited, because I know you went to places that are a part of your book. You went to Table Mountain in Africa and things of those natures, the Barrier Reef, Great Barrier Reef. And
yep, that's Table Mountain right there.
I shot most of that, in all that stuff in Los Angeles, locations in different places.
Oh, okay.
We shot it, you know, and it was like that. See, the thing about the Black exploitation or the Afrofuturism is you know, there's three things that have to, the movie has to have: the past, the present, and the future, in the same movie, right? I didn't think about anything like that when I was doing that movie. It just, those things were, sort of came to me, right? Mm-hmm. So I was shocked to find out that, oh, well, that's what Afrofuturism actually is. The past, the present, and the future in the same movie, right? Oh, okay. I didn't know that when I made it, that just happened because, like I said, it was given to me from some spirit, from a spiritual place. It was given to me, write this stuff, do this stuff, and I don't know, see what happens, right? And that's where all that came from. And so you know that, because you're from Afrofuturism, that's what they say.
It makes me think about Sankofa, the go back and fetch. We must look at our past to right. embark on a future that would be, you know, better than the last generation. And this is certainly saving the world this way in this talk. And I just want to appreciate you guys.
I just want to tell you one more thing. I went to a producer and I took the script right here and Top of the Heap, and I gave it to this producer, and he called me in and said, and his whole thing was, you know, you should be not an astronaut, but a baseball player. He said, that's something Black people can do, right? This is what he actually said to me, right? That's something Black people can do, right? And I said, that's not my movie. My movie is that he's an astronaut. And that's important to me as an author of this thing, as a creator. He said, well, you know, you can't be an astronaut. You can't, right? And this was like I said, 12 years before, right? So I said, okay. I took my script back. I said, you know what I said? And I walked out of the office, you know, and I kept at it until I found this guy who was like, what? He was the one that wanted 90 minutes of niggas running around, right? So I said, well, okay, you put up the money, I'm gonna do my movie. That's all. And so we made a deal. And that was that. And so, but you see the kind of things that people think, we have to change their thinking, right? And that's why I was so upset about Will Smith, because that one little gesture, that one thing he did was set us way back. It did, you know? Right. And I thought we were making real progress, even though there are plenty of people from way back there who are still thinking the same things about Black people and thinking the same things and want to hurt Black people. And the whole thing about the exploitation was all about white people in Hollywood surviving. They were going through a really bad time in Hollywood and they weren't surviving money-wise. And so they started doing all these Black movies. They didn't care what it was. Any Black movie, they call it Black exploitation. And you do it. They made something like, what, 400 moves or something like that? And they were trying to survive themselves because the studios weren't functioning well. They were really bad.
Wow.
You know, I had the guy, United Artists, the head of United Artists called me in because I sent him a screenplay, another screenplay I have, and I sent it to him during that period of time. He called me up and asked me to come in and see him. He's the head of the studio, United Artists. And he says to me, he says, I just wanted to call you in because I like this script a lot, you know? And it was called Waiting for Robert E. Lee. Right? Waiting for Robert E. Lee. And Robert E. Lee was a young Black guy who was 17 years old, right? Who had gotten into a thing in Alabama. He saw his father lynched in Alabama. And he had, and his mother sent him away immediately, right? And he came to New York and he didn't know what to do. His name was Robert E. Lee, right? And so when I think about it now, the name Robert E. Lee, because people, Black people, name their children after people like that, way old, back in the South. And this movie takes place in the 50s and 60s, right? And so this guy was like that, and he says, you should be a baseball player because you can't be no astronaut. And that upset me so much.
And it leads me
to myself.
Sorry, it leads me back to the point of the ideological production has to be your own, right? It can't be fabricated by what somebody's point of view is of what.
Exactly. So things like this happen in Hollywood. It used to be that the white producers were in charge of everything. Studios were in charge of everything, right? And they did whatever they wanted to you, right? And they said, change that, take that out. That story about they said the film was too long. So the producer picks up the screenplay, reaches, opens it up, tears a bunch of pages out and says, now it's short enough. Go do it. Now it's short enough. He tore them up, then now go do it, right? That kind of thing, see? So those kind of things happen all the time in Hollywood. And Hollywood was like against us from the beginning. But a lot of brothers did a lot of stuff to even before Hollywood was functioning like it is still today, they were doing a lot of stuff, great stuff. That's why I told a friend of mine, I want to start a post Academy Awards for all the Black people who did great projects even before me, way back, going way back, and they were never recognized in any way. But what they did, they did some great, great films, and I want them to be given some kind of award posthumously, because most of them are dead, right? And so we got to do this. We have to do this. I want to do it before I kick the bucket. I want to see it happen. That some of those great guys and ladies who did some great work before and were done in by the media, were done in by the studios, that they can be rewarded for this work that they did. Some great work was done.
You know, it's funny. We have
a lot of great work.
Quintard Taylor, we did a talk last week, and he has a blackpast.org site where he chronicles all of these things, and some of which are some of the Black movie stars, and that would be a great place to start this post Academy Awards. Okay, yeah, but it's 3:22, so we're gonna have to do a part two. But I want to thank you, okay, Christopher St. John and Leonard, for just a great organic discussion. And I do want to end it off based on what you've been saying. Frances Cress Welsing, she has this book, Isis Paper. She died in 2016, but she is a, let me just quote her. She says that Black people are afraid, but Black people are going to have to get over their fear. Black people do not know what is happening, but Black people are going to have to learn and understand what is happening. Black people are not thinking, but Black people are going to have to begin thinking. Black people are not being quiet, but Black people are going to have to start being quiet so that they can think. This speaks exactly to what you had just inspired us with, this talk, Christopher St. John and Leonard Clifton. I really appreciate what we had today in this space. Any lasting comments before we go?
I just want to say, I just wanted Christopher to just do his thing at the helm of the wheel. And I'm honored to be in the room with this man. He created great art for all of us. And I'll just say this real quick. You're asking about the Will Smith thing. You know, everyone's seen it online, but you know, everyone has their sides. I just want, for me personally, just to become just a better human being and in the future, a better producer. I just inspire the world. That's all I want to do. Just inspire the world with just positivity.
Thank you. And Christopher.
Last thing I want to say is that I want to say to the young people, I don't care if they're actors or if they're directors or whatever they are, or if they're lawyers or doctors, et cetera, we always got to remember, thoughts are living things. Bam. Thoughts are living things, and we are able with our thoughts, our right thoughts, to change the situation forever, right? Because they're going to try to keep us down forever. Believe me, as time goes on, they're going to try to keep us down forever. But we can change that ourselves, right? We can change that ourselves, and we have to keep going. We have to just have to keep going. And remember, thought. that. As
I think we lost him there.
Yeah.
But I can say that that was very sensational. I know we went over the time, but I hope you thoroughly enjoyed it. For the folks who are still here, let's give a virtual round of applause for Christopher St. John and Leonard Clifton. Thank you so much. And we're definitely going to do a part two. This was very interesting. We're just barely scratching the surface in terms of all this knowledge that these two young men, Leonard Clifton, and I still say Christopher, young man, young in thought. He said, thoughts are living things. You heard that here live. You guys have a blessed one, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you. Atlantis.